Welcome back to embryology session on development of alimentary system. Here comes part 3, development of midgut. We will be focusing on following objectives in this part. They are formation of midgut loop, its rotation, formation of derivatives of midgut, their fixation, histogenesis of midgut tube, and congenital anomalies. Let's begin with the formation of midgut loop. Primitive midgut. It's a part of primitive gut tube, extends between anterior and posterior intestinal portals. Ventrally, it is connected to yolk sac through vitellointestinal duct. Here is the primitive midgut, which is suspended dorsally by dorsal mesentery. At the beginning of fourth week, it shows a ventral U-shaped loop in the median plane, known as primary intestinal loop. It has an apex ventrally and a base dorsally. Apex is attached to vitellointestinal duct. Through the base, artery of midgut, that is superior mesenteric artery, enters into dorsal mesentery to supply primitive midgut. In relation with the course of superior mesenteric artery, the primary intestinal loop or midgut loop can be divided into two parts. Upper part, called as cephalic limb or pre-arterial segment. Lower part, called as caudal limb or post-arterial segment. Now the branches of superior mesenteric artery supplying two segments of midgut loop can be called as pre-arterial branches and post-arterial branches. During fifth week, primitive midgut loop grows in length, whereas vitellointestinal duct starts regressing. Here is the cephalic limb and here is the caudal limb of midgut loop. At this stage, it shows two clear borders. Dorsal border, to which the dorsal mesentery is attached, can be called as mesenteric border. Ventral border, which is free of attachment of any mesentery, can be called as anti-mesenteric border. The anti-mesenteric border of caudal limb close to vitellointestinal duct give rise to an endodermal outgrowth known as cecal bud or cecal diverticulum, which in future give rise to cecum and vermiform appendix. The cecal bud plays a major role in further development of primitive midgut loop. Let's observe this image to understand the further growth of primitive midgut loop. Here is the cephalic limb and here is the caudal limb with cecal bud. Here is the regressing vitellointestinal duct with definitive yolk sac. As the midgut loop grows in length, abdominal cavity fails to accommodate the growing loop so that it protrudes or herniates ventrally into umbilical cord. As the umbilical cord encloses extraembryonic coelomic cavity, which can accommodate the growing loop. Externally, what we see is a mass at the umbilical region as umbilical sac enclosed within fetal end of umbilical cord on the ventral abdominal wall of a growing fetus. Such a herniated midgut loop seen at the umbilical region as umbilical sac can be called as physiological umbilical hernia, which starts appearing at 5th week and stays till 10th week of development. Now let's move on to next objective, rotation of midgut loop. Further changes seen in primitive midgut loop during 6th to 12th week of development can be studied in 3 stages, 1st, 2nd and 3rd. By the end of 12th week, primitive midgut loop give rise to its definitive derivatives after passing through 3 successive stages of development. During first stage, cephalic limb of midgut loop grows enormously than the caudal limb. Its proximal part lying in the abdominal cavity now pushed downwards by growing right lobe of the liver, so that cephalic limb starts rotating downwards towards right side. Eventually, caudal limb moves upwards towards left side. So the primary intestinal loop starts rotating towards right side around superior mesenteric artery, taking it as an axis. The rotation is 90 degrees towards right side, which is anti-clockwise rotation when it is viewed from ventrally, so that cephalic limb becomes right limb and caudal limb becomes left limb after rotation. The point here to be noted is, it is the pre-arterial segment which is moving towards right side, whereas post-arterial segment is moving towards left side. By the end of first stage, primitive midgut loop shows 90 degree rotation towards right side. During second stage, the pre-arterial segment in the umbilical hernia starts growing enormously and arranged in coils. Simultaneously, cecal bud in the post-arterial segment grows prominently than the rest of the post-arterial segment. Growth of right and left limbs in the physiological hernia is seen till the end of 10th week. By that time, abdominal cavity expands and allows the re-entry of herniated loop. But the herniated loop cannot enter into the abdominal cavity as a single mass, because the umbilical ring where the umbilical cord is attached to anterior abdominal wall is narrow, and it does not allow the reduction of the loop as en masse. By the end of 10th week, reduction of midgut loop starts by re-entry of pre-arterial segment into abdominal cavity. So it is the right limb which is reduced first, as the bulky cecum in the left limb can't return so easily through narrow umbilical ring at this stage. Initially, right limb coils occupy right half of the abdominal cavity. Later on, the right half of the abdominal cavity fails to accommodate huge aggregation of coils, so that the proximal part of pre-arterial segment starts migrating towards left side. Such migration is seen dorsal to superior mesenteric artery. Now let's observe this image. Here is the midgut loop between anterior and posterior intestinal portals. Here is the umbilical ring through which reduction of the midgut loop is happening into abdominal cavity. Here is the right limb and here is the left limb of the loop. As the right limb reduces into abdominal cavity, it occupies initially right part, then dorsal part, then left part of the cavity by pushing the dorsal mesentery of hindgut towards left side. So the major changes here to be observed are, as the pre-arterial segment migrates towards left side, dorsal to the superior mesenteric artery, the lower part of duodenum, which is derived from the proximal part of midgut, lies behind the superior mesenteric artery. At the same time, entire hindgut occupies left part of the abdominal cavity. Now it's the time to reduction of left limb or post-arterial segment. It is last to re-enter the abdominal cavity. To be specific, it is the cecal bud which enters the abdomen lastly. Once it re-enters, it occupies the left part of abdominal cavity. as the left part is already flooded with the coils of pre-arterial segment, cecum and distal part of left limb search for free space and they start rotating upwards towards right side for 180 degrees. The rotation is seen around superior mesenteric artery, superficial to coils of pre-arterial segment. So the post-arterial segment here rotating towards right side for 180 degrees, taking superior mesenteric artery as an axis, passing ventral to the artery. As the cecal bud is last to re-enter the abdominal cavity, initially it occupies left iliac region. Once it starts rotating towards right side, it moves into umbilical region. From there, it moves towards subhepatic region, towards right side. So by the end of second stage, cecum and appendix pass successively from left iliac to umbilical, from there to subhepatic regions of abdominal cavity, after completing 180 degrees of rotation towards right side. Let's see what are all the major changes happened in second stage during 7th to 10th week. The pre-arterial segment reduces first into right part of abdominal cavity. From there, it migrates towards left side by passing dorsal to superior mesenteric artery. Later on, the post-arterial segment reduces into left part of abdominal cavity. The cecal bud initially seen in the left iliac region, it starts rotating towards right side for 180 degrees, superficial to the coils of pre-arterial segment and ventral to superior mesenteric artery. The rotation is anti-clockwise rotation when it is viewed from ventrally. After complete rotation, cecal bud occupies subhepatic region. So by the end of second stage, midgut loop undergoes reduction as well as 180 degree of rotation towards right side. In first and second stages, during 6th to 10th week, midgut loop undergoes 270 degree of rotation towards right side, which is anti-clockwise rotation. So that pre-arterial segment goes dorsal to superior mesenteric artery, whereas post-arterial segment goes ventral to superior mesenteric artery. Such positions of pre- and post-arterial segments define positions of their definitive derivatives in future, such as lower part of duodenum lies dorsal or posterior to superior mesenteric artery, whereas transverse colon lies ventral or anterior to superior mesenteric artery. Let's move on to third stage. By the end of second stage, cecal bud lies in subhepatic region. From there, it starts descending towards right iliac region. While doing so, it passes through right lumbar region. By the end of 12th week, cecum and appendix reach their definitive position in right iliac region. So the third stage is all about descent of cecum and appendix from subhepatic position through right lumbar region to their definitive position in right iliac region. It's worthwhile here to note the positions of cecum and appendix during midgut rotation. Initially, they lie at left iliac region. From there, they move to umbilical region to subhepatic region by the end of second stage. In third stage, they start descending through right lumbar region to reach their definitive position in right iliac region. So the primitive midgut loop undergoes three successive stages of development during 5th to 12th week, in which it shows herniation, reduction, rotation and descent, giving rise to its definitive derivatives. Let's summarize the changes seen in rotation of midgut by looking at the following video clip. Here is the primitive midgut loop with its cephalic limb and caudal limb, which is herniated into umbilical cord here. During first stage, it rotates 90 degrees towards right side so that cephalic limb becomes right limb, caudal limb becomes left limb. During second stage, the post-arterial segment starts rotating superficial to the pre-arterial segment and superior mesenteric artery towards right side for 180 degrees so that the cecal bud reaches subhepatic position. In third stage, cecum and appendix starts descending towards right iliac region, which is their definitive position. So the primitive midgut loop undergoes 270 degree of anti-clockwise rotation, in which 90 degree seen in physiological hernia and 180 degree of rotation seen in abdominal cavity. Now let's see the derivatives of midgut. Here is the primitive midgut loop with its cephalic limb and caudal limb. Let's see the derivatives of cephalic limb. Its proximal portion gives rise to lower part of duodenum. Distal to that, jejunum and ileum, except for its terminal part. So the pre-arterial segment gives rise to parts of small intestine. Caudal limb derivatives are terminal part of ileum, close to vitellointestinal duct. The cecal bud gives rise to cecum from its proximal portion and vermiform appendix from its distal portion. Rest of the caudal limb gives rise to ascending colon and proximal two-thirds of transverse colon. So the post-arterial segment gives rise to a portion of small intestine in the form of terminal part of ileum and a portion of large intestine from cecum and appendix till proximal two-thirds of transverse colon. Let's see the derivatives of midgut loop in their adult position. Pre-arterial segment derivatives are lower part of duodenum, which passes deep to superior mesenteric artery. Here are the coils of jejunum and ileum till its terminal part, from where post-arterial segment derivative starts. They are terminal part of the ileum, cecum and appendix, ascending colon and right two-thirds of transverse colon, which means transverse colon has dual developmental origin. Its right two-thirds derived from midgut, whereas its left one-third derived from hindgut. It's worthwhile here to mention adult cecum features, as it shows variations in its shape. Depending on that, it is classified into four types. Fetal type, where the cecum is conical in shape and the appendix arises from its apex. It is seen in 2% of individuals. Infantile type, where the cecum is quadrangular in shape with right and left saccules, which are equal in size. Appendix arises from the bottom of the cecum, midway between right and left saccules. It is seen in 3% of individuals. Adult type or normal type, seen in 90% of individuals, where right saccule of the cecum enlarges more than the left saccule. So the appendix lies 2 cm from ileocecal junction. exaggerated type, which is seen in 4 to 5% of individuals, where right saccule of cecum enlarges more and left saccule undergoes atrophy, and the appendix is situated very close to ileocecal junction. Let's move on to fixation of midgut derivatives. Fixation, it can be defined as disappearance or persistence of dorsal mesentery so that the definitive structures become retroperitoneal or suspended respectively. Fixation of midgut derivatives starts after the complete rotation of midgut loop. To understand the fate of dorsal mesentery of midgut more clearly, we will take the primitive midgut loop with its dorsal mesentery and superior mesenteric artery. In relation with the course of the artery, dorsal mesentery of midgut can be divided into pre-arterial segment and post-arterial segment. Proximal portion of dorsal mesentery of midgut will disappear so that lower part of duodenum becomes retroperitoneal. Dorsal mesentery of midgut suspending jejunum and ileum will remain as mesentery proper or mesentery, so that jejunum and ileum will remain suspended. Dorsal mesentery suspending the cecum will disappear so that cecum becomes retroperitoneal, whereas vermiform appendix suspended by a portion of dorsal mesentery known as mesoappendix. Portion of dorsal mesentery of midgut suspending the ascending colon will disappear so that ascending colon becomes retroperitoneal, whereas dorsal mesentery suspending proximal 2/3 of transverse colon remain as transverse mesocolon, which suspends the entire transverse colon derived from midgut as well as from hindgut, so that the dorsal mesentery of midgut remains as mesentery suspending jejunum and ileum, mesoappendix suspending vermiform appendix, and transverse mesocolon suspending transverse colon. Mesodermal cells in the dorsal mesentery of pre-arterial segment at the junction of lower part of duodenum and jejunum proliferate to form a thick band known as superior retention band. Similarly, mesodermal cells seen in the dorsal mesentery of hindgut at the junction of transverse colon and descending colon proliferate and form a thick band known as inferior retention band. Superior and inferior retention bands derivatives we will be looking in further slides. Let's see the fate of dorsal mesentery of pre-arterial segment in definitive position. Here is the lower part of duodenum, which becomes retroperitoneal. Here is the jejunum, continuous with ileum, which are suspended by mesentery. The superior retention band attached at duodeno-jejunal junction will remain as a fibromuscular band known as ligament of Treitz or suspensory muscle of duodenum. Let's see the fate of dorsal mesentery of post-arterial segment. It remains as mesentery in continuation with the mesentery of pre-arterial segment to suspend the terminal portion of ileum. It suspends the appendix in the form of mesoappendix, whereas it disappears at cecum and ascending colon, which become retroperitoneal. Here is the ascending colon. It continues as transverse colon at a bend known as right colic flexure or hepatocolic flexure. The transverse colon is suspended by transverse mesocolon, which lies deep to the stomach. So the retroperitoneal midgut derivatives are lower part of duodenum, cecum and ascending colon. Let's see the fixation of these structures in following video clip. Here is the dorsal mesentery, a cross section through it showing ascending colon here and jejunum here. The dorsal mesentery of ascending colon fuses with the peritoneal layer of dorsal wall and disappear, making it retroperitoneal. The suspended midgut derivatives are jejunum and ileum, which are suspended by mesentery, vermiform appendix suspended by mesoappendix, and transverse colon suspended by transverse mesocolon. In later stages, transverse colon and transverse mesocolon are covered and fused with greater omentum, which is the derivative of dorsal mesogastrium. Let's understand this by looking at the following video clip. Here is the sagittal section taken through the developing greater omentum and dorsal mesentery. Here is the transverse colon with transverse mesocolon. They fuse ventrally with greater omentum. Now let's move on to histogenesis of midgut. Histologically, only the mucus lining, epithelium and glands derived from endoderm, whereas the rest of the layers of midgut derived from splanchnopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm. A point here to be noted is smooth muscles around the midgut are arranged in two layers, inner circular and outer longitudinal. The inner circular muscle layer differentiate earlier than the outer longitudinal muscle layer, so that peristaltic movements start from fourth month itself. Now it's time to see the congenital anomalies of midgut. Abnormal persistence of vitellointestinal duct. If the duct remains patent throughout, it connects the ileum internally and umbilicus externally. It starts discharging intestinal contents through umbilicus. Such condition is known as vitelline fistula or umbilical fistula. If the duct remains patent in the center and connected to the adjacent surfaces by vitelline ligaments, such condition is known as vitelline cyst or enterocystoma. It may lead to inflammatory conditions. If the duct remains patent proximally towards ileum and converted into vitelline ligament distally towards umbilicus, such condition is known as Meckel's diverticulum. Few points about Meckel's diverticulum are noteworthy here. Meckel's diverticulum is seen in 2% of individuals. It is located at terminal part of ileum with 2 cm in length. It is placed 2 feet distance from ileocecal junction. So the points to be remember here are, it is seen in 2% of individuals, 2 cm in length and lies 2 feet distance from ileocecal junction. The distal part of the Meckel's diverticulum may be free or connected to the anterior abdominal wall by a fibrous band or vitelline ligament. In such condition, the intestinal coils may loop around the fibrous band, causing intestinal obstruction. Exomphalos or omphalocele. The herniated midgut loop, after first stage of development, fails to enter into abdominal cavity and it retains in the fetal end of umbilical cord, where it is covered by amniotic layer. It's a defect in second stage of midgut loop rotation. non-rotation of midgut. It's a second stage rotation anomaly due to dilated umbilical ring, because of which herniated midgut loop reduces into abdominal cavity as N mass after initial 90 degree of rotation, so that post arterial segment derivatives occupy left part of the abdominal cavity, whereas pre arterial segment derivatives occupy right part of the abdominal cavity. Such incomplete rotation of midgut loop known as non-rotation of midgut. Mal rotation or reverse rotation of midgut. It's a second stage rotation anomaly due to dilated umbilical ring, in which after initial 90 degree of rotation, cecum enters the abdominal cavity first. It rotates 180 degrees behind the superior mesenteric artery, so that transverse colon lies behind the superior mesenteric artery, whereas duodenum lies in front of the superior mesenteric artery in definitive position. Such abnormal rotation of midgut loop known as mal rotation. Subhepatic cecum and appendix. It's a third stage or fixation anomaly where cecum and appendix fail to descend into right iliac region, so that they remain in subhepatic position. Here is the cecum, here is the appendix. The right iliac region is occupied by terminal ileum. Cecum continues directly with transverse colon. Intussusception, where a portion of intestinal wall folded upon itself and enters into adjacent intestinal lumen, causing intestinal obstruction. Most commonly seen at ileocecal junction. Valvulus, a portion of intestine may twisted upon itself to cause intestinal obstruction. In later stages, it may lead to necrosis of that part due to lack of blood supply. Here is the end of part 3, development of midgut. Thank you for your patient listening. Keep learning.